Doors open at 3 p.m., showtime 4 p.m. Proceeds from this fundraising event will benefit the Jamaican American Association of Northern California Scholarship Fund and the St. Paul AME Church Men's Ministry. Steve Higgins sang and toured internationally with the Jamaican folk singers for 20 years. He appears locally and internationally as a tenor soloist and an accomplished and respected master of ceremonies. Jamaican tenor Steve Higgins, Saturday, April 25th. 4 p.m. at St. Paul's AME Church in Berkeley. For more information, call 510-854-6413.
And you are listening to 94.1 KPFA in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 1 p.m. Up next, Project Censored.
Welcome to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff with Peter Phillips. On today's program, we'll look at smart meters, electromagnetic frequencies. We'll be looking at both some of the health impacts as well as domestic surveillance. We'll look at the impact of smart meters through the lens of Pacific Gas and Electric users, as well as the California Public Utilities Commission. Joining us for the hour will be Cindy Sage of Sage Associates, an international environmental sciences consulting firm from Santa Barbara, and Sandy Moyer with the EMF Safety Network. We'll close out the program with Ken Burrows. He is an educator and lecturer at San Francisco State University, and he is founder and director of the Holistic Health Learning Center. Please stay with us.
Political ties, political lies, alibis, skies, another guy's democracy, politics, the apocalypse, got the skies looking ominous.
Welcome to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff in studio with Peter Phillips. Today's program, we look at various aspects involving smart meters, electromagnetic frequencies, and Pacific Gas and Electric users in California. We'll also bring into the mix the role of the California Public Utilities Commission. There are many things going on with smart meters outside of possible health impacts and risks, including spying. And this is something that's been confirmed by the American Civil Liberties Union. So today's program will be getting into all of these issues. And here is Peter to introduce our guests today. Peter?
We have two guests today. Sandy Maurer is a director of the EMF Safety Network, which helps people reduce electrical pollution, EMFs and wireless, to improve their health, vitality, and protect children, communities, and nature. Sandy's the leader in the campaign against utility smart meters. Also joining us today is Cindy Sage. Cindy is the co-owner of Sage Associates in Santa Barbara, California. Sage Associates is an internationally known environmental science consulting firm. The company specializes in translating complex technical and scientific information for the public and decision makers. Her specialty of practice is in the science of public health effects of electromagnetic fields, radio frequency radiation on ionizing radiation. Ms. Sage has provided expert testimony and scientific briefings to the European Environmental Agency in Denmark, the European Commission in Brussels, UK Health Protection Agency, and numerous other organizations, school districts, and counties around the country. Welcome, both of you.
Thank you. Thank you for having us on.
You recently sent us a research article that had come out by Dr. Ronald Powell. It says, Symptoms After Exposure to Smart Meter Radiation. Could you tell us about that study? Sandy, let's start with you.
This is a comparison between a survey that the EMF Safety Network did and a peer-reviewed study that was done in Australia. And the symptoms in the two different places are very similar. The top symptoms from exposure to wireless that are being reported are sleep problems and headaches, ringing in the ears, stress, anxiety, irritability, and concentration, memory problems, and many others.
And this is a study that was reported on 318 individuals after exposure to wireless utility meters in the U.S.
That was the survey.
Cindy, give us a little bit of the science on this. There's Wi-Fi, there's cell phones, there's now smart meters that are kind of interconnected on all of this. What's the science and how is this impacting our health?
The science has grown to be very strong in the last decade. We produced a compendium of the science and public health effects and posted that for international distribution, first in 2007 and then again in 2012. It was updated. This report's the Bioinitiative report, available to everybody for free download. And what it does is it profiles somewhere between 4,000 and 5,000 peer-reviewed published studies, primarily on wireless technologies and their health impacts. And the takeaway message from this is that every year the evidence grows stronger that things that emit pulsed radio frequency radiation, like cell phones, cordless phones, wireless routers, wireless laptops, baby monitors, and a lot of these devices, even wristwatches now, or medical implants, are genotoxic, meaning they damage DNA, a necessary precursor for cancer. They are neurotoxic, meaning they create neurological effects that short-term are as you are hearing with smart meters, but long-term are creating neurological diseases that are very serious, Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, and that whole suite. And they're a very large indicator. These studies are an indicator that when we take these technologies into schools and we affect children in their daily learning environment, this is one of the worst things that you can do to create a learning environment for children, because it interferes with memory and cognition. Is there good science? You bet there is.
This is Mickey Huff, Project Censored Show. Again, thank you for taking time to come on with us today. Cindy and or Sandy, this is a technical question, and perhaps you could quickly straighten out some of this. We at Project Censored have covered these stories for several years now, accumulating evidence of ongoing wireless technology health hazards. In fact, that was the 14th top story in our Censored 2015 book. And we've done shows on wireless phones before, and they emit radio frequency electromagnetic fields, or RF-EMFs. Is this the same or similar type of thing that we're talking about with smart meters and many of the other devices you just listed?
It's exactly the same thing. Anything from 700 megahertz up through about 2.45G.
The reason I wanted that clarified was because even the World Health Organization has concluded that RF-EMFs are possible human carcinogens. And PowerWatch in the United Kingdom has done various studies on this. And again, I just want to point out that we're certainly not trying to be quote-unquote alarmist on the show or on the program regarding public health issues. But I think the data strongly suggests that it's not alarmist to employ precautionary principles, nor is it alarmist to state what the peer-reviewed studies and the data are saying as they gradually come out.
Exactly.
Could you expand on some of that?
Sandy?
This is exactly the reason we filed at the California Public Utilities Commission. We asked for a moratorium on the deployment of smart meters for precautionary reasons. We asked for the safety studies, and we asked for hearings, safety hearings, and we asked for the right to opt out. And the CPUC basically just blew us off. And they knew, the president of the PUC knew that smart meters were harming people. And I can read you the exact quote if you're interested.
Yes, please.
Okay, so he also intentionally delayed handling the situation. So I'm going to start with the quote from PG&E's Brian Cherry. He's the vice president of regulatory affairs. He's writing to another comrade at PG&E, and he says this. He says, Mike, and he's talking about Mike Peavy, grumbled about the city and county of San Francisco petition for modification. They had also asked for a moratorium on smart meter deployment. And the folks in Sebastopol, that would happen to be us, because we also filed a formal application and asked for a moratorium. Who want to delay smart meter implementation? He implied this was not going to happen, and that by the time the commission got around to acting on it, we would have installed all of our meters.
Explain again who these individuals are and who Michael Peavy is.
Michael Peavy is the president of the California Public Utilities Commission. They are a state-funded agency. They are they're there to regulate the utilities. They receive $307 million a year for this. So the second quote is that the president of the PUC, well, we're going to call it the CPUC, That's the California Public Utilities Commission. The president, he knew that smart meters were harming people. And this is what he says. So he's writing to PG&E's Brian Cherry, who, again, he's the vice president of regulatory affairs. He says, if it were my decision, I would let anyone who wants to keep their old meter keep it if they claim they suffer from EMF or related electronic-related illnesses and can produce a doctor's letter saying so or expressing concern about the likelihood of suffering the same. I would institute such a policy quietly and solely on an individual basis. There really are people who feel pain, et cetera, related to EMF, et cetera. And rather than have them becoming his hysterical, etc., I would quietly leave them alone.
So this is the chair of the Public Utilities Commission in California.
Correct.
Saying that they acknowledge that there are people who are harmed.
Correct.
Yet they're proceeding to go ahead and push for the full installation of smart meters in all of PG&E's territory.
Correct.
So how do we know this? I mean, how did you acquire these emails from these executives?
There is a federal investigation going on right now of PG&E and the CPUC. I think they have three criminal cases going. We know that one of them is about the blast in San Bruno, the gas explosion there. It killed several eight people and destroyed many, many homes. And so the city of San Bruno sued the CPUC to access the emails because PG&E turned over 65,000 emails to the federal authorities for this investigation. City of San Bruno sued for access. The CPUC posted these emails online, so now they are publicly accessible.
Could you share with our listeners any of the web addresses or places where they can find this information for themselves? Or could it be linked from one of your own sites?
Yes, exactly. You can go to emfsafetynetwork.org, and the information is there.
Michael Peavy is the former chair of the Public Utilities Commission. Is that correct? He's not currently chair?
That's right. He retired in December.
Of course, that's very recent. So these emails are within the staff of the California Public Utilities Commission, and there were some communications directly to PG&E encouraging PG&E not only to install smart meters on everybody's location, but to kind of cover up or hide the health impacts?
Exactly.
Cindy, tell us your perspective on that. What's going on here?
Well, I've been a consultant with my own business for 45 years, and I don't think I have ever seen contempt from a public agency that rivals this saga with the California PUC. We were involved with Sandy from 2010 on, but my history with them goes back into the late 90s. And this is a part of a pattern of conducting sham hearings. It's been an appalling failure of government on EMF and radio frequency issues for as long as I've been involved. Our role in this was to provide technical information so people could actually see what kinds of levels of radio frequency that smart meters would produce in the way that they're being installed and operated, as opposed to the way that they were tested in isolation chambers at the FCC where they receive their compliance. And what I can tell you is that these meters, especially PG&E's meters, which are different than Edison's and different than SDG&E's, produce more radio frequency. And in many cases, the way they're installed and operated will actually violate what are currently grossly outdated FCC public safety standards. Even where they don't violate FCC standards, which, by the way, are now under review, formal docket review at the FCC, they're still so high. They're tens to hundreds of times higher in normal installation situations than the health studies we're reviewing through the bioinitiative would say should be avoided for chronic exposure.
Well, one of the articles that we covered in Project Censored by Professor James Tracy talked about media blackouts on smart meter dangers and, in fact, cited particularly corporate news media coverage in the U.S. consistently reassures the public that the Federal Communications Commission, the FCC, found smart meters to be within its safety standards and that they impose no danger to one's health and that they are, quote, environmentally friendly. And what you're suggesting is that that is not necessarily advice that's keeping up with the data?
No. I would say it is grossly incorrect, deceiving and misleading.
I would like to add that the whole smart meter deployment, not only in California, but worldwide, is basically a propaganda campaign.
Well, let's talk about that here. We're speaking with Cindy Sage, Sage Associates International Environmental Sciences Consulting Firm in Santa Barbara, and Sandy Marr with the EMF Safety Network. I'm Mickey Huff with Peter Phillips. You're listening to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. You just said something about this propaganda campaign. Can you elaborate on that?
The smart meter deployment actually came from, it's like a top-down propaganda program. And PG&E got on board because they're stand to make a lot of money. They make more than 11% interest, and this program was at least a $2.2 billion campaign. A whistleblower said it was a $10 billion deployment of smart meters. So they make money off of it, but it started with the PUC, and the PUC actually partnered with PG&E on the propaganda campaign to sell smart meters to the public. And not only did they use PG&E propaganda to respond to people with the RF complaints, they also used it to dismiss the legal filings by using propaganda that says, you know, these meters operate within the FCC guidelines and blah, 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 that they're just like every other device that you have in your home. They use that in legal filings to dismiss our filings. So, yeah, Cindy?
Let me ask this. My understanding from what I've read that you presented, Sandy and Cindy, the Public Utilities Commission in California encouraged the installation of smart meters, and other PUCs around the country, Oregon and other places, also have done that, and that in some cases it's very profitable for companies, but it was originally and has been presented as if PG&E was wanting to do this. In fact, they've been encouraged by the Public Utilities Commission. You talk about a propaganda campaign. That was to encourage people to accept this, that it's really better, you'll be more efficient use of your electricity and that, and that you should save money. But in many cases, the electrical costs have gone up. And there's a couple of problems that seem to come forward here. One, when these systems are all interconnected on the Internet, they can be hacked. So people can actually change their electrical use by hacking them and maybe pass it over to their neighbor. The other part of this is national security agencies monitoring this information. Could you elaborate on those two issues?
I would like to tell you, in a little segue, but I'm going to stay on point here with this, and that is in the emails, I found a data response that PG&E had sent to the Energy Division about smart meter fires. Now, smart meter fires have been reported all over the world where smart meters are being installed. And they happen in two ways. One is through overvoltage, so they can happen inside of a home through electrical outlets, appliances, or they can happen from overheating, which is at the meter. The meter can explode or catch fire. So there is this data response that PG&E has sent to the Energy Division. And they're responding to the issue of fires. Most of it is redacted, but we know that there's a problem. They're responding to it. They say that now they've put sensors in the meters so that they can monitor the voltage and the overtemperature, which really didn't help them at all. Recently in Stockton, there were dozens of smart meters that exploded off homes when there was a power surge. But what's really interesting about this, and this is getting back to the surveillance issue, is that within this data response, they're talking about the fire issue, but then they say PG&E is now leveraging the data that its electric smart meters provide to promote public safety, an unanticipated benefit of the substantial and valuable data that these meters can provide.
Which means that they're going to sell it to third-party vendors, and there is nothing illegal about it. So anything that's being transferred over the wireless system, which is full of security flaws for all of these California utilities installing them, is going to become a commercial product. Your time of use, how much you use. And they're also hackable by people driving down the street with a Wi-Fi detector to see when your electrical use is high and when it's not. It's like hanging a sign out saying, rob me.
We're speaking with Cindy Sage, Sage Associates, Environmental Sciences Consulting Firm in Santa Barbara, as well as Sandy Marr with the EMF Safety Network. We'll be right back after this musical break, and we'll talk more about the American Civil Liberties Union remarks and the use of smart meter technologies for domestic surveillance. Please stay with us. Welcome back to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff with Peter Phillips. Today on the show, we're looking at various issues surrounding smart meters, electromagnetic frequencies. We're looking at the case of California, particularly, where these issues have been somewhat pronounced, involving the Public Utilities Commission, Pacific Gas and Electric. So we're not only looking at environmental concerns and health concerns involving smart meter use, we're also looking at how these devices are being used for domestic surveillance. And in fact, the privacy rules that by the California Public Utility Commission allow disclosure of smart meter data for legal purposes or, quote, pursuant to situations of imminent threat to life or property. For example, in California, San Diego Gas and Electric records showed over 6,000 customers. And let me read you this. In 4,000 of the San Diego Gas and Electric cases, information was subpoenaed by government agencies, often in drug enforcement cases or efforts to find specific individuals individuals, according to the utility. The other 62 disclosures claim as a result of subpoenas and civil lawsuits, and some of the released information focus solely on billing information, account addresses, and other data that could be used to locate an individual. And this was a quote from the San Francisco Chronicle some time ago, but it is also the case that we are seeing that this is information that can be sold to third parties, as was mentioned earlier in our conversation. So we're speaking with Cindy Sage of Sage Associates and Sandy Meyer of EMF Safety Network. Cindy and Sandy, could you comment a little bit more about some of these issues concerning privacy and the Northern California ACLU reports on how smart meters are being used, it has been determined, are being used for domestic surveillance, both with government and to sell to third-party customers?
My comment would be that the smart meter deployment is just a gross abuse of public trust. I mean, no one would think that a meter on the side of your home would harm you or would be, used for surveillance.
The question about privacy and surveillance is one that has not been answered because the California Public Utility Commission has not even deemed it to be an issue to be considered before these things are rolled out. And the rollouts, by and large, are complete across California. So we now have a situation where there is no control and there is no reporting about how information can and will be sold for commercial purposes to people who want to advertise to you or for surveillance reasons that may relate to government investigative programs at federal and state level. And so we are in a situation where every single home, every electrified building in California, except for those where people have opted out and pay extortionist fees, are little listening posts, and they can be used in various ways to collect data and information. The people inside that house have no idea.
Sandy, the Public Utilities Commission requires that the utility companies disclose an annual report that says, yes, government agencies made a request for one customer, 86 for PG&E, 4,000 for San Diego Gas and Electric. But the ACLU report is quite clear that a single request doesn't mean it's a single person. A single request could be a million people.
There may be some better controls on specific kinds of things that would be interpreted as review of metadata, how they get that through their programs. But you have to understand that these are wide open systems for any hacker. And so the value of this information to the utility is to be able to sell it, as well as to have to cough it up when they have a specific governmental request. That's where the money is.
So the smart meters can be interconnected to all the Wi-Fi activity in your home, correct?
The plan is for the Internet of Things, which is going to be an RF chip in every appliance that you have. And you may have read this already, but there was some kind of Trojan horse or something that was started in the refrigerator that was in the news.
The wireless systems, you can call them Wi-Fi or not, technically, you know, one of the antennas that's inside of every smart meter is a Wi-Fi antenna, you know, defined by frequency. But the point is these wireless systems are going to grow inside the home in the sense that you're going to have wireless antennas radiating from the meter on the wall outside where your main electric meter is. But as new products and appliances are rolled out, you're going to have a power transmitter, meaning an antenna, radiating radio frequency in every one of those. Refrigerators, dishwashers, washers, dryers, and all of these things are meant to report their data usage, meaning energy usage and time of day, back to the main electric meter, smart meter, and then that's going to go by wire off to either cell towers or mesh networks as a part of a larger wireless system. And so at every juncture, you have the potential for somebody to insert malware. Maybe it's as simple as turning off your television. On the other hand, it might be taking your power down or the power of a neighborhood.
Well, in a related issue, but not for this program, we know that certainly some of the new smart TVs, the voice recognition feature on it actually records what you're saying and sends it back to servers, even when the TV may be off. But that's another issue and problem.
Do you ever wonder what it will take to trigger people to say, I can't believe they could do that to me in my own home for something I paid for, and I don't even and know it.
It seems like a serious violation of the Fourth Amendment to the Constitution, but I wanted to reiterate this point, that I know a lot of people that hear this kind of talk, they tend to say, oh, this sounds like some kind of outlandish conspiracy, or people are paranoid and so on. And I want to reiterate that, you know, the World Health Organization has come out issuing reports about possible health concerns surrounding these devices. But also, regarding the issue of spying, the Northern California ACLU literally said, this is a quote, transparency reports filed by the California utilities companies and obtained by the ACLU of California show a significant amount of data about energy use of Californians is also ending up in the hands of third parties. In 2012, a single California utility company in San Diego, right, the one that we mentioned earlier, disclosed the smart meter energy records of over 4,000 of its customers. I mean, so this isn't speculation. We know that this kind of thing is happening. What we're trying to find out, of course, is how exactly might this information be used in ways that, even if it was based on consumer habits or to serve the public and so forth, there are too many other nefarious possibilities that can come out of having access to this kind of data.
Right. And after researching these emails between the CPUC and PG&E, I believe that the purpose of the smart meter deployment is for surveillance. It is for the data. And it is a global program. And it just brought up a lot of questions for me of who started it and why, you know, because it's being sold. It's being sold to the regulators, sold to the utilities. And it is on a global level.
So the Public Utility Commission essentially has asked the utilities to expand this program, and even when people object, they now have to pay a fee not to have a smart meter. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And where is the fee generating? I mean, was this the idea of PG&E? Was this the idea of the Public Utility Commission? Where is this $75 opt-out fee?
Well, I have a cartoon on the report that will be on the website, but basically they pulled it out of their AFFS. It was basically punitive. They're trying to stop people from not wanting the smart meter. It was coercive. It's purely a coercive move, and it was coordinated between the PUC and PG&E. That $75 came out of nowhere.
And that's in the emails.
Yes, and basically what they did is they went back and forth, and PG&E said first they were going to socialize the cost, and then they decided they were going to charge $200, and then they asked Commissioners Peavy and Florio, what do you think of this idea? We charged them $200, and Peavy came back and said, well, why not $250? So they and Florio said, yeah, I agree, $250. And then a monthly fee. And then when they filed the application, it had gone up again to $270.
So the Public Utility Commission representatives are advocating to charge an even higher fee to profit the PG&E.
Well, I think the reason they jacked it up so high is so then they could take it back down so Peavy could look good. So then he takes it back down to $75 and $10 a month.
Hey, that sounds like a bargain.
Well, he did it so that people would think that this PUC was actually regulating, when indeed they never were.
Wow, that's some interesting political theater, and that's all in these emails. Could you repeat your website? Both of you, repeat your websites again for our listeners so they can go and find these documents. And again, even if listeners go to these websites or see that, you know, maybe there's something there that they don't like or disagree with, you have these linked to the primary documents, and that's what I want people to see.
Yes, it's emfsafetynetwork.org.
My contribution here is going to be for people who want to see the science and public health consequences. If you're not convinced yet, please go to www.bioinitiative.org, bioinitiative.org.
That's the voice of Cindy Sage from Sage Associates in Santa Barbara, consultant on EMF issues to agencies all over the world. And certainly very concerned about the healthcare issues of this. And we're expanding this to talk about how this has been imposed on the public here in California and in other states, and encouraged by the Public Utility Commission. The California Public Utility Commission actually encouraged PG&E to not only install them on everybody's meter, but encouraged fees if you did not or you resisted. And that is the policy that is set today. So let's talk real quick. There's concerns, too. There was an increase in costs for some people's meters when the meters were put in. Their electric costs went up. These meters can be hacked. we were reading in Denmark and other places that there's actually hackers who will go to somebody's home, hack their meter, and reduce their costs.
That's all possible. And one of the points you have brought up here, Peter, I think that's important for people to know, is that if you have a wireless implant of any kind, for example, if your child has a wireless insulin pump to alert you if they're diabetic when they need another dose of insulin, these things are hackable. In fact, proof of that was done by a fellow at Black Hat who is himself a diabetic who thought, one day, I wonder if it's possible, and he hacked his own wireless insulin pump. You can do this with any kind of radio frequency-based wireless medical device. So when you go slapping these new smart meters with very, very strong intermittent pulsed radio frequency, you have the potential here to set off electrodes might not work in deep brain stimulators for people with Parkinson's, wireless insulin pumps may not work, and so on. This is now not just about money and deceit. This is about life of people. And that's apart from the health effects that occur to healthy populations of people from chronic exposure to radio frequency radiation. This is about undoing the medical implants they depend on.
There was one report how National Security was concerned about Dick Cheney and his heart monitor, that someone could hack it and cause him a problem, and so they turned it off. Is that true, or is that?
Yeah, you know, I had mixed feelings about that, of course, but there's more than proof of concept here. It is a clear problem that we cannot predict what will happen. For example, if you have a deep brain stimulator and you get on an airplane in business class and everybody turns their cell phone on, or they're going to turn on and use the wireless now available on many flights, this is more than sufficient pulse radio frequency to undo the electrodes in a deep brain stimulator or affect a pacemaker or a defibrillator or a wireless insulin pump, and yet people have to fly. So this is entirely unresolved.
Let's hear from both of you here. We're going to conclude this segment, but we wanted to hear from both of you some final remarks and, again, reminders where people can learn more information. I think, again, the bottom line of the program for us today is public awareness, being able to raise critical questions based on evidence, learning more about where to find this kind of material and information, right, other than, of course, the corporate media that we know routinely lies and distorts information for profit and to benefit advertisers and owners. But Cindy Sage, let's start with you. What are your conclusive remarks for our listeners today? And then Sandy Moore will go to you. Cindy?
Yeah, well, here's the take-home message based on the science and public health. It is really a very mature body of scientific evidence now that is warning us that chronic exposure, meaning the exposure that you get from a smart meter on the wall of your home in a room where you spend time, is over that which will cause health effects, immediate health effects that are inconvenient but long-term may result in cancer and neurological disease, and large impacts on reproductive health. So we are talking about very fundamental health rights that we believe are violated for many people by the mandatory installation of smart meters and generally by having grossly inadequate public safety standards from the FCC. So people need to be aware that they're going to have to dig for information if they want to prove this to themselves. I would encourage them to go to the Bioinitiative Report or the World Health Organization International Agency for Research on Cancer, acronym is IARC, I-A-R-C, and read for yourself that this is now categorized as a possible human carcinogen, and that is radio frequency pulsed that comes from cell phones, cordless phones, baby monitors if they're electronic, wireless routers, and other wireless devices. Do not give them to your kids. Do not use them yourself except with great care and reduction. Go back to the basic ways of communication and reduce your exposures. And by God, don't put this stuff in schools. iPads, wireless has absolutely no place in schools because it interferes with learning and memory. And this is all based in science that is readily available, hard fought and dissed by the industry, but that's no surprise, is it? If you look at tobacco, if you look at asbestos, and the long history of toxic chemicals where there's a large industry profit to be made, this debate will go on. So people need to educate themselves, and they need to start dialing back tech.
That's the voice of Cindy Sage with Sage Associates International Environmental Sciences Consulting Firm out of Santa Barbara. Cindy Sage, thank you for joining the Project Censored program today.
Thanks, Mickey.
I would also like to bolster partially the final statement by Cindy there. There are numerous governments and major organizations that actually have warned about wireless technologies, EMFs, and so on. And there are several countries that have actually now banned the use of some of these things in schools, particularly preschools and around young people. So again, this isn't just outlandish, paranoid, reactionary kind of sentiment or behavior, and we certainly encourage people to do more reading and research about this, particularly as these devices and this kind of EMF or this kind of radiation becomes more ubiquitous in our culture and in our society. Sandy Moyer of the EMF Safety Network, let's hear the conclusive remarks from you today.
Yeah, well, I want to thank you both for having us today. And the point about conspiracy is this conspiracy. I think that the industry, one of the ways they keep that propaganda going, that this is conspiracy, and they do it through different ways. One of the ways is they hire shills to comment on articles in the news. So if you see articles, see comments on articles in the news, many of those, especially those that are using the words like tinfoil hat or conspiracy, those are people who are being paid to say those things, and you probably know that very well in your industry, in the, you know, in your work. And I think if the California Public Utilities Commission, if they stay together, if they don't get disbanded after all these criminal probes, the new president is Michael Picker, and what he told the U.S. California Senate, he said that what they were doing, their focus was going to be hardening their legal core, and they've hired an $800-something an hour criminal attorney to represent them. But if they can get their act together, I think what needs to happen is we need to have no cost return of the analog meters, and they need to hold hearings and safety hearings on smart meters.
That's Cindy Meyer of EMF Safety Network. Thank you.
Excuse me, I just wanted to reiterate the website where you can get these emails. It's emfsafetynetwork.org. And thank you again.
Sandy, on your website, there's hundreds and hundreds of people reporting their health impacts that they've had since smart meters were installed in their homes, and it's quite amazing reading.
There's also a page on, there's also a compilation of the fires that have been reported, the smart meter-related fires as well.
We thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you.
You're listening to the Project Censored Show. Our guests so far have been Cindy Sage with Sage Associates, International Environmental Sciences Consulting Firm in Santa Barbara, California, and Sandy Marr of the EMF Safety Network. Coming up after this break, we'll be joined by Ken Burrows, who teaches holistic health studies at San Francisco State University. Stay with us. the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff in studio with Peter Phillips. Today's program, we're looking at smart meters and EMF, domestic spying. But in addition, we're looking also broadly at electromagnetic frequencies, Wi-Fi radiation. That's been part of our conversation. And we're joined now by Ken Burrows, who's been an educator and consultant for over 30 years, teaching holistic health studies at San Francisco State University since 1991. He is the founder and director of the Holistic Health Learning Center at San Francisco State University, which has a unique interdisciplinary library and community action center integrating personal, social, and environmental aspects of health. Ken Burrows is also on the board of the Media Freedom Foundation, which oversees Project Censored. And we have had several contributions from Ken Burrows over the years, including numerous from his students to our books and top stories. Many of them revolve around health issues. And we are very pleased to welcome Ken Burrows to the Project Censored show today. Ken, thanks for being with us.
Glad to be here. Absolutely.
Ken, let's just start broadly about your knowledge and experience based on some potential problems. And let's look at this again more from the cautionary principle than perhaps an alarmist one. But what can you share with us about concerns about this kind of technology and its effects on us?
You bet. Well, there's a lot of peer-reviewed research, and there are levels of concern. There's a recent announcement by the California Medical Association. But just to step back and think of course, a big part of the discussion has been around the safe concerns around meters. But cell phones are so active in use, that's also a major, major issue. But the California Medical Association recently passed, as recent as December of last year, an attempt to really reevaluate microwave safety exposure and to really associate the limits of various wireless communication devices with this whole field of non-ionizing electromagnetic radiation that shows up in wireless communications. And they've gone on to say that their concern as physicians, and this passed, by the way, on a vote of 107-14, after looking at the data of peer-reviewed research around wireless communication and what it's doing to human biology, that these wireless devices are really a form of environmental pollution. And there's a growing body of peer-reviewed scientific evidence that shows significant health, adverse health and biological effects. And these effects include, and I'm reading now from their announcement, single and double-stranded DNA breaks, creation of reactive oxygen species, immune dysfunction, cognitive processing effects, stress protein synthesis in the brain is altered. Brain development can be altered, certainly early in life for a young person. And for anyone, sleep and memory disturbances, ADHD, abnormal behavior, sperm dysfunction, brain tumors, and the list goes on. So they've listed, after much review and much discussion, and resolved basically that the existing public safety limits for microwave EMF devices are really outdated and inadequate. I'm reading again the words. To protect public health, and thus they endorse the Federal Communications Commission to really reevaluate safety standards for this kind of radiation that we're increasingly interacting with.
Ken Burrows, hi, this is Peter Phillips.
Hey, Peter.
We've been talking about smart meters today, but this is all part of a package, so to speak, of EMF devices, including our cell phones, Wi-Fi, various appliances that we have, including televisions that can do this. And there's been several studies now, one here in the U.S. done by Eric Haltman in 2011 of 318 individuals exposed to wireless utility meters and the symptoms they had. Another one done in Australia exposing people after they had wireless smart meters installed in their homes. They're all saying basically the same thing you just said. Sleep problems, headaches, ringing in the ear, concentration and memory problems, fatigue and muscle weakness, eye problems, cardiac symptoms. And so that's quite serious.
Obviously. It's become a global phenomenon. We're basically a massive experiment. And also the telecom industry is actively resisting any peer-reviewed studies that seem to indicate that we should look at this more closely. So there's active institutional involvement with limiting good scientific input to some of these things, and we can talk more about that if you'd like.
Ken Burroughs, I know you've done conferences and with some of the people involved in these peer-reviewed studies and so forth. Could you tell us a little bit about where can you guide people to get more information on this? And I know that I think it was maybe a year or two ago you had a whole weekend conference and you had a lot of this information coming out, the stuff that the telecom industry, of course, works to suppress.
Right. Well, there are a number of resources. One of my favorites is the Environmental Health Trust. That's an active website headed up by Deborah Davis. Dr. Davis was an epidemiologist very focused on the outcome of such studies on human health, and she basically was forced out of her tenured position as a professor of epidemiology. So her site is very active and current. I'd highly recommend that. It's Environmental Health Trust, ehtrust.org. Also a fairly current documentary that someone who had been collaborating with Dr. Davis and others called Mobilize, which is about the use of mostly cell phones, but also various other EMF devices.
We had Kevin Coons on the program some time ago about that, and also the Berkeley, California City Council member that was trying to draft a resolution such that the warnings that are inside these devices would actually be taken out of their sort of four-point font, microscopic 30-page thing that no one reads and actually placed on the outside of the box.
Wouldn't that be amazing? One of my students, in fact, wrote a story on the likelihood that this ordinance will pass and also the complications if it does. Because when this happened in San Francisco, there was, of course, illegal.
Right.
Snafu, and they had to rescind their law and rewrite it. And they're actively doing that rewrite now in Berkeley in hopes that it will actually pass the legal muster so that we can actually just get the information we need about our phone. Certainly in Europe, there's much more awareness of the precautionary principle than here and much more an active use of that. So if you see something as a likely problem, you can actually head it off before it becomes an actual problem. We don't have that practice here as a policy driving mechanism, but it certainly seems wise to consider it.
You know, despite that, Ken Burroughs, if you go back and look at some sites, some compilations of research regarding various governments and organizations that either ban or warn against wireless technologies or warn about some potential problems.
Mm-hmm.
Again, cellphonetaskforce.org is one such place.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, even just to look at it, again, I said this earlier in the show, it isn't such that people go there and believe everything they're seeing and so on. It's just this is another source of information that is blocked out of the corporate media, basically, even though since 1993, the Environmental Protection Agency said that the Federal Communication Commission's exposure standards were seriously flawed. The Food and Drug Administration in 1993 said the FCC rules don't address long-term chronic exposure to RF fields. And we've seen this all over the world. The National Institute of Occupational Safety and Health warned this in 1993. The UK Department of Education warned that children under 16 should not use cell phones, and that was all the way back in 2000.
Yeah,
I know
yeah.
people will argue, well, the technology has changed, and they're safer now, and this kind of a thing. But if you take a look at that and you go through, you know, we're talking about Bavaria, Germany's parliament, the Democratic Party in Australia,
Yeah.
European Environmental Agency. I'm belaboring the point here on purpose. The National Library of France, the City of Paris, France, Russian National Committee for Non-Ionizing Radiation. How about this? The University of Pittsburgh's Cancer Institute in 2008 said that children should not use cell phones unless it's an emergency.
Mm-hmm.
So again, this isn't just people on some fringe that are paranoid about this kind of usage. The Israeli Minister of Health in 2002 warned against Wi-Fi in schools. The Supreme Court of India in 2013 said these are hazardous to health. Mumbai, India warned about this. I mean, again, I am belaboring the point, but that point is that this isn't just simply Henny Penny, the sky is falling, and an alarmist tirade. This is a real concern because of how many of us use these devices. Isn't that right, Ken Burroughs?
Well, of course it is, and the most obvious study that's fairly current is as of May 2011, 30 scientists from 14 countries met at the International Agency for Research on Cancer, basically an affiliate with the World Health Organization, and they declared electromagnetic fields and electromagnetic radiation as basically probably carcinogenic. And yet you get conversations still going on in the New York Times fairly recently about the controversy. They don't seem to really pair the science with, they seem to go back to 25 years ago and talk about there's not much we've learned since then. We have learned a lot.
Well, there's not much they've learned.
Well, they're not announcing, but back to this point of quote-unquote censorship or lack of coverage. They're really not announcing the latest science, and not all the science is actually being even picked up. There's a fascinating, if anyone wants to find their way to the Harvard Law Forum, the Center for Ethics held an event in 2011. One of the lead researchers in this European study, when he was about to announce his research, was much more definitive about what electromagnetic fields do and how their exposure limits literally display gene-damaging potential. And he was announcing this research, and he got attacked by the telecom industry, and claims of fraud came up about his research. And so his research was not actually included in this massive European study, which would have changed and made the actual study much more definitive had it been there. So it's interesting, within a week he was being attacked after announcing his findings. And so he spoke at Harvard recently about what he called institutional corruption and how that's really an active resistance to scientific findings. Makes it really difficult for us to somehow be in a full dialogue, whether you're the New York Times or anyone else.
Well, Ken Burroughs, I want to thank you for the work you do, certainly at the Holistic Health Center at San Francisco State University. I just recently spoke there, and it's always a delight to see your students, to see the work you're doing. And again, I think that the message today is based on full awareness, transparency, and the right of the public to know the things that are happening in the society, particularly around our health. So, Ken Burroughs, San Francisco State University, thank you very much for joining us on the program today, and we'll certainly have you back on in the future to discuss related items.
Glad to be here, Mickey.
Supporting human conditions, not free market propaganda and corrupt politicians, cause they own by special interests who set fund their campaign. It's why you hear the same old things they claim, but change never came. It's a dirty game maintained by...
You've been listening to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. Special thanks to our producer, Anthony Best, and our engineer, Erica Bridgman. The Project Censored Show airs on over 20 stations around the United States. Archives of our previous programs can be found online at projectcensored.org. Please follow and like us on Facebook. We'll see you next time. Stay tuned for Terra Verde.
Potential being at the table, then you're probably on the menu.